So this is what I mean by comments, multiple comments. If you have multiple lines like this,
Okay.
this is expected to take in a code. Like I said, I am here today. So instead of just using hash all the time like this, for example, you want to comment like 100 lines, you
Okay.
understand? You want to take it out of your code just to comment it. Sometimes you use comments for debugging your code. You can comment out some parts, silence some part,
Okay.
and look at what your output will be if those parts are not in the code. You understand
Okay.
that? So if I have
Okay.
several lines of code, maybe x equal to 5, y equal to 10, x plus y, a lot of codes like this.
Okay.
How to comment it? You can't be using hash. You can just use multiple line comment, which is one, this thing like this, 1, 2, 3, 3, and 1, 2, 3. So all this will be out of the code.
Okay.
And so it's multiple line comments. Once you run
Okay.
this, you won't get anything because it is, for example, if you have this now, you see that this part is out of the code.
Yes. No problem.
So that is what I did here. That is what I'm trying to do here. I want to take that out
Okay.
of your code and try it in my own way. Like instead of this, you might
Okay.
also put your exception here. Try. So which means that we are trying everything at all. Trying everything.
Okay. Okay.
Even within this try, you have returned your value that you want to return. Then return C1, return grid. You understand that? So else.
Okay.
You can then error. I mean, except error.
Okay, so more.
Except.
Okay, I thought you said anything after the grid will not work. That was why I didn't put it after the grid.
No, is that okay? Anything after return.
Return rather, yeah.
You don't know that this particular return is between this block statement. It's not controlling the old return.
Okay.
So which means that this return will only be executed if this try, if it has tried everything and it see that it is correct. There's no way it is coming back to this particular part. But anyway, you get an error.
Okay.
So like this now, you can see that it's going to print error because it has tried this particular input and said that the input is invalid, is not cannot be added with numbers or cannot be compared with numerical values. So that is why you have an error.
Okay.
So that is about the first assignment. So let's look at the second assignment. Okay, in this second assignment, what are we going to do?
Yeah, we're supposed to get a prime number between 1 and 100. That's the first one. The second one is populate 10 names in small letters and convert them to capital letters. That's the second one. Then
Okay.
the third one.
The first one is what? So you can try
Find
to
your
make sure you are always
prime
using
number.
annotations anytime you want to write code so that you can always come back to it and say that this is what you've written. Like this, you can write
Okay, okay.
what you do here, the assignment,
Okay.
like this.
Okay.
But you can use comments to write it.
Okay.
You can see that you can use comments like this. And then, so every of your assignment, make sure you always put this. Assignment, you can put assignment dates.
Okay.
You put date of the assignment and
Okay.
what you have put to task. So what you have put to do here. So you put it there so that you always know what this assignment is for. Anytime you want to
Before.
come back to your code.
Okay.
So this will do what here.
Get a prime number between 1 and 100.
Five number between 1 and
prime 100. Numbers between 0 and 100.
Okay, prime numbers between 0 yes. and 100. So and we couldn't get that. What logic are you using to print prime numbers?
Like I was just trying everything. Like I didn't even know what I was doing, to be honest.
Okay, like what logic do you think you can use to get prime numbers? Like what are prime numbers?
Like they are divisible by 1 and I think themselves.
Okay. Meaning that prime numbers are only numbers that are divisible by 1 and itself. Which means yes. that if you have a prime number like I equal to 5, or let's say I equal to 9, which is not a prime number.
Okay.
So, which means that if we look through this I for I, or let me say for J, or let's use Y. Y, okay. I.
Okay.
But let me use another iterator, which J equal to 0. Y, J. Okay. Is less than, that is greater than, is less than
okay.
I.
Okay.
Then I can set a counter. I want to know how many times, like this counter, this is to be 0.
Okay.
So you can see that most prime numbers, it can only be divisible by two things, which are yeah. 1 and itself.
Yes.
Which means that I can say that if the claim starts from 1, you understand that you can okay. see that if J percentage I equal to 0.
Okay.
Which means that if you divide J with I, and it leaves no reminder. That means that it is divisible, like we can divide J by I.
Okay.
Then we are going to increase our counter, counter plus equals 1. Okay. So at last, we are going to display our counter. Then we just to make sure that this will keep on repeating itself, we are going to increase iterations, like then that will be J plus equal to 1. Okay, this should be I percentage J.
Okay.
So let's now see that at each step here, we are going to print I percentage J. So at the end of the day, you see that your counter here is 2.
Okay.
So what I'm trying to do is that I look from 1 to what? 9.
Okay.
Let's say that I is that number that we are going to use. Like, okay, instead of I'm going to name it to be num, so that we can easily differentiate it from this J. So this is the number we want to find. We want to determine if this num is, determine if num is a prime number.
Okay.
So for num to be a prime number, what is the criteria?
For num to be a prime number, it must be divisible.
For 9 to be a prime number, what should be a criteria?
It must be divisible by 1 and 1 on itself. How that's many? A remain.
Let's just say that it must be divisible by how many things?
Two things. Yes.
Or let's say that at most, how many things?
At most 2 things.
Okay, let's say that you are starting from 2.
Okay.
We are starting our counter from 2. This J is counter. Counter variable. If we start from 2 to number minus 1, Like, we are not going to get a number. In this one's not even going to get a number. For J is less than number, he's not going to get a number. So this is our counter. This, if you look at this particular, if you start from this,
okay,
it means that we want to divide 9. We want to test 9 divided by 2.
Okay.
9 divided by 3. 9 divided by 4. 9 divided by 5. 9 divided by 6. 9 divided by 7. 9 divided by 8. That is where we want to stop.
Okay.
Which means that if number is 10, it's going to be what? 2, 2. 10 divided by 2, 10 divided by 3, and up to 10 divided by 9.
Mm-hmm.
Do you understand the logic?
Yes, I do.
So if you then divide all these numbers, if the numbers of those that are actually divisible, that the remainder is actually 0, it is 0. That is, there is no number that it is divisible within this range, then that number is a prime number. Do you understand that logic?
Okay.
Do you understand the logic?
Yes, I do.
Okay. So if you look at this, then what we need here is the counter. This counter, if I try to silence this, you can see that counter will be equal to 1. Counter should be even equal to 7. Okay. We are starting from J to be equal to 2. Okay, let's print this so you can know the numbers that have been tested. Okay, I'm going to format it. We say percentage S divided by percentage S. The remainder of percentage S. So percentage, you understand for this format now?
Yes, yes.
Num J comma num percentage J. So it means that 9 divided by 2 leaves a remainder of 1. 9 divided by 3 leaves a remainder of 0. 9 divided by 4 leaves a remainder of 1. 9 divided by 5 leaves a remainder of 4. 9 divided by 6 leaves a remainder of 3. 9 divided by 7 leaves a remainder of 2. 9 divided by 8 leaves a remainder of 1. So we only consign with this remainder of 0. Like 9, once it's divided by 3, it leaves a remainder of 0, which means that this 9 cannot be a prime number.
Yes, yes.
At least there must not be. Then it must divide all two and make sure that it leaves no reminder.
Mm-hmm.
Do you understand that?
Okay.
So 9 cannot be a prime number. So you can then test for maybe 7. 7 is actually a prime number. You can see that it leaves no, it is 0. The counter is 0.
Mm-hmm.
And this counter is going to count the numbers of times where it is actually divisible by a particular number. That is, numbers of times it leaves the remainder of 0.
Okay.
Do you understand the logic?
Yes, I do.
So programming is logic. You just have to think like, let me take it this way, let me take it this way. But you understand this implementation code. Why are we use this counter to count the numbers of time. Numbers of time. Not is divisible by a number between 2 and num minus 1. That's between 2 and if num is 7, so it's going to test from 2, 3, 4, 5, and up to 6. Do you understand that? If you have a number like 41, 41 is actually a prime number, so it's going to test everything. I still going to return 0 because it's going to find that there is no way 41 can be divisible if you starting from 2. Do you understand that logic?
Yes, I do.
Okay, so now, how do you now convert this to print all those numbers from 2 to 100? Do you understand that?
I don't.
This particular code that we implement is just to check if a particular number is prime or not.
Okay.
It's not going to print prime number from 2 to 100 as stated in this assignment.
Okay.
So now we've already know that, we've already have helped you to this extent that I created a code to check if a particular number it is even or it is prime or not a prime number.
Okay.
So how do we test? How do you now use this particular code to print prime number from 2 to 100? That is the condition.
From them in range 1 to 100.
Let's try that. Let's try range. I'm going to use another line of code. I can always have this.
Okay.
If you have this, you can then look for. Let's see, for num in range 2 to 100. So now we have num that is taking over this num. So we don't need that particular static num that is always 41. So now we keep on changing from 2 to 100. So from here, it has not said that if counter is equal to 0. That means there is no counter. There is no numbers. Then print num. So I can silence this so I won't be getting all this at every num that is testing it for. So you can see this. So these are the prime numbers we have.
Okay.
You can see that we approach the logics between two terms. Do you understand this?
Yes, yes. But this counter variable, I still don't understand it. I don't understand how it works.
Okay. The counter variable, yeah.
Okay.
This counter is set as 0 at first because it's going to count the numbers of time when it divide num by j and it leaves a remainder of zeros. As we tested for this 41 year, it does not leave a remainder of 0 here. So counter will still remain as 0. It does not leave a counter of 0, a counter will still remain as 0. So until it leaves the remainder of 0, that is where counter will increase. So yeah, counter will always be 0 because it is a prime number. So if you have something like 10, if you run for 10, you can see it leaves a remainder of 0 here, leaves a remainder of 0 here, so 2 times, so counter is 2.
Okay.
You understand that?
Okay.
So which means that if we divide within this period, we divide 10 by 2, like we did here, if it leaves a remainder of 0, the counter should increase. So do you understand that? So
yes, I do. That
if num is divided by j and leaves a remainder of 0, then we are going to what? Increase counter that was initially set to 0. Do you understand that? So in the case of n, counter will be 2. What happens if it is in case of, let me say 16? What will be counter in the case of 16? Hello.
Yes, I'm you.
I said, what will be the counter in case of system? So if you want to consider it's going to test for 2, the system divided by 2.
Yeah.
When that is 0, so just like we are looking for the divisible numbers that are divisible by 16 between 2 and 15. So 2 is there, 4, 8, which means that counter will be 3.
3, yes.
Counter will be 3. So you can see that counter is 3 after testing for everything. So until counter is, until our counter is 0, that is when we can say that a number is an even number. For example, 19. So after testing for everything, counter will still be 0 because there is no way the remainder is 0. So that logic what we now extend, they will now look from not from 2 to 100. You understand? So use that logic to define for each of these numbers. Then decide if it leaves the remainder of 0 before. You understand that?
I do.
Okay. So let's now move to, you understand this particular assignment, like as we assigned this, so the solution to this assignment.
Yes, I'll have to go through it again on my spare time.
And go through it, text to Tamale Logics. So this is the second assignment, this is another assignment. You have names. So we are going to look forward.
To make them uppercase.
Uppercase, okay. For I in names, we print I dot upper. Okay. So that's okay. So what happens if you want to save it in a list? How do you now extend it? So putting it.
We append it. So we append it to the list. I want to.
You have to create an empty list. Name underscore upper.
Upper.
So at each time, we now say that name upper dot append I dot upper. So here we have name underscore upper. Be the list with the upper letter that we desire. Okay, so let's make the assignments for now. I'll need to send this particular file again to you, right?
Yes, so I can go through it again.
Okay. Okay, I need to print passport to this. Our seventh class. So into this class, I'm going to introduce you to another block statement. In this block statement, we talk about the objects oriented programming. So, the object oriented programming is mostly called OOP. So OOP, object oriented programming. The key word, the statement we use for that is class. That is the key word.
Okay.
That is Python statement. So what is OOP? OOP, what OOP actually stands for is a way of writing code in such a way that Python actually supports OOP by object-oriented programming. Is a way of writing code in such a way of representing them is in form of an object. Do you understand?
Okay.
Representing them in form of an object. Good. In form of objects.
Okay.
So like, so being an object, our code can do a particular thing. It can actually do some other things.
Okay.
Do you understand that? So for example, if you have a string is an object. Do you understand like a string? String is an object. You understand that?
Okay.
So string is an object. So it is an object because if you have a string like this, this is a string. It's an object because one Python will understand that this is a string. It's a string object. It's an object because it can do some things like upper, like splits. Do you understand that?
Like, okay.
So think of anything like counts. So that is the reason why we call it an object. So building your own object is what you want to do. You can build your object yourself and specify what and what this particular thing can do. Do you understand that?
Okay.
So to do that, let's say you have want to build an object of a footballer. So the first thing you do is specify the class, keyword, class footballer. That's the first thing. So class footballer will say that this, you are creating an object of a footballer.
Okay.
So that's the first thing. So the next thing, you have to define your properties, which is the init function. So you can see I put two underscore, def underscore underscore init underscore underscore. So this means that it's initialization, like you are defining the property of this polar object. Are you there?
Yeah, I'm here, I'm listening.
Okay, so the next thing that will be here will be self. Self is a keyword, self will always be there. So I'm going to tell you what this self is. So let's say you have this footballer. The first property will be self dot name. I'm going to give it a default property, which is, let's say, self dot name Ronaldo. Self dot, let me say, pass accuracy equal to 80. Self dot go
age.
Let's say age equal to 36, something like this.
Okay.
So now I have to put an indent because it's a function.
Okay.
So now you can create several footballer using this instance of a footballer, using this class of a footballer. So this the next is now called instancing, like creating an instance.
Okay.
Something like this. We are creating an instance, just like the way we call a function. This is just a template to create a footballer.
Okay.
So for example, I can create any kind of footballer, like you can see that player one equal to footballer. I'm going to call this player two equal to footballer. You can now look at that player one now. Look at this player one dot name. So I'm going to get it to be Ronaldo, because we set a default name to be Ronaldo.
Okay.
Okay, let's now say that instead of saying that this self means that this object takes a, this particular function takes a default argument of itself. Do you understand that? So this, as I'm creating an instance here, is taking one argument, which is its own self argument. Do you understand that?
Okay.
And we are still going to get it better now. Let's say that instead of this self.name, I'm going to create an argument here, name, comma, age. Do you understand that? Comma, age. So instead of this getting a default name, I'm going to give it a name. Yeah, I'm going to give it a age. Then we'll leave this pascal accuracy to 80. So in this case, before I can define, call this instance of the player, I have to provide this name and age. Do you understand that? So let's say I'm going to create the first player to be Messi. And I'm going to say that age should be 34. I'm going to create another player to be Ronaldo. And I'm going to give the age to be 36, something like this. You can see player.name change to, let's see, player2.name is going to change to Ronaldo. You understand this?
Okay.
But instead of getting this, I can even say that if I cannot call this particular function, I cannot say that player one. I cannot call this particular function like this. Okay, footballer. I cannot create an instance of a footballer without providing these two arguments, name and age. I cannot call it. I cannot create it. Without providing this argument, so it should be footballer like this. I cannot create an instance of a footballer without providing name and age.
Okay.
Let's say player three, I want to create another instance of a footballer without providing it. So this means that this self is not a compulsory argument that it should take. Anyway, this self, just keep that particular argument. The next two arguments is what is required.
Okay.
Do you understand? Like this, the name is required and the age is also required.
Okay.
Do you understand that? The name is required and the age is also required here.
Okay.
So that means I cannot create a footballer instance without providing the name and the age.
And the age.
Okay. So instead of this now, I can even say that is equal to Ronaldo. Okay, let's say that I have the age to be 32 here. So it means that I can still provide the name. I can still skip this particular age. I can only I can just provide a name like as a Suarez. It's going to accept, but it's going to take a default value of 32, just like we did in functions.
Okay.
Do you understand this?
Yes, I do.
Okay, so we can then create several functions. This post function, this self _ init, is to define the properties of the footballer. You can create some other functions like def. Let's see that injury. This is going to take the default of self. Then I'm going to say it's going to take default of yourself. So once this function is God.
Okay.
This the pass accuracy will reduce, let's say minus equal to 50. It's going to reduce by 50. So which means that this player one, this player two, if player this player three, if player one is called like player one dot injury, that's how to use a particular function within this class object. It's like player one dot injury. This means that we are calling this function of injury.
Okay.
Do you understand that? It takes no arguments, just brackets. It's only taking the itself as an argument. And this is the self, player one. The self means like the instance of an object, which is footballer. So like footballer.injury, once you call these functions, let's look at player one dot pass accuracy. You see that it will have reduced because we have called a particular function. You can see.
Okay.
You can see. That means that that's how we create an instance of that's how object-oriented programming works. It behaves like an object in which it can do some things. In this case, we are saying that our player has an injury by calling this particular function. Do you have any question?
I don't understand.
Okay.
Can you give me like maybe a scenario where we use something like this? So maybe you can make me understand.
Okay. And you are still going to get it better. So this is just the first example. The first thing you should know that in object-oriented programming, we call functions, the class, the function overloading or like operators, or overloading, something like this. And the first thing you should always look for is underscore init. So this underscore init is to define the property of the class, or instance. Do you understand that? It's just like we've created a template of creating multiple instances. So this is what it means. You want to create a footballer. We have like a template of footballer. Do you understand that? So with this template now, you can use to create multiple footballer. You understand that? So to create multiple footballer is that you have to what? Call this particular function. Once you just call this particular class, like as we did here, like footballer one equal to player one equal to footballer, then what you need to define is this underscore init. That is what you use to call this function.
Okay.
Do you understand that? If this underscore init takes no argument, if nothing is here, you need to provide arguments. The numbers of arguments that it takes, then you have to provide the numbers of arguments here.
Mm-hmm.
Do you understand that?
Yes, I do.
Okay. But you can define your own functions like this. This function is what we define it. It's not required once we first call this, first create an instance of an object like this. It's not required at all. Okay, let's look at another example. I'm going to create an example. Let's do that. Def. Okay, class animal.
Okay.
So this is a class object of an animal to create animals, different kinds of animals. So you see that def. So underscore init is the first thing we need to define. So this first thing is what we will define what and what we need to. Is to call this particular instance to create a duplicate or a children of this template that we want to build.
Okay.
Let's see that for us to call these numbers, for us to call the animal, we will need to define the name of the animal, which is very, very important.
Okay.
We will now need to define the number of legs. I will need to define the numbers of hands.
Okay.
So we can then see that self.name will be equal to the name that we define. The property of that name of that animal will be equal to the name of that what we defined.
Okay.
Self.number of legs underscore legs will be equal to the number of legs we provided. Self.num and will be equal to the number of
and
provided and. You understand that?
Okay.
So to call this function, I can ask that, let's say I want to create an instance of dog. I want to create a dog. Okay. So I'll ask that animal. Then I have to provide the first thing. The first argument is what?
Name,
which is, let's say that dog.
Okay.
That is the name. Okay. Then the legs, I can answer that. Let's say that. So four is zero and four legs.
Okay.
You can see that. So once I create this, it means I've created an instance of this particular template. That is me. So let's say that dog now. It is going to tell me that this is an instance of an animal that I've created.
Okay.
So I can ask that what is the name? Dot name. These are the properties that it takes, which is dog, which is name.
Okay. So dog dot number of legs to show us.
We also show us the numbers of legs. Dot numbers of legs. So this also shows us zero.
Okay.
Okay, I think we.
Yeah, we misplaced it.
Yes, we interchange it. This should be.
Zero, it should be four and zero.
Yeah, it should be four and zero.
Yes.
4, 0. So then you have something like this. So dog dot num and so you have something like this also. Zero. Do you understand that?
Yeah, okay.
Do you understand that?
Yes, I do. So it's just like maybe you're trying to maybe create profiles for certain things, right?
It's just like you have a template code, you want to create something similar.
Okay.
Do you understand that?
Okay. So it's just like creating templates that I can use for, let's say maybe for students now. So I can create maybe for this student, the age, their favorite subject, something like that.
Exactly. Just like okay. A template that can be used to create multiple things.
Okay. I get it.
Okay. So with this now, you can even create functions within this. So creating a function, let's say that we have a function like, let's say we have a function, you can say that def dot, you can create a function. These functions of init is just a defined, is what Python will first look for. That this is what is required to call to create an instance of a function of this particular class.
Okay.
So Python will always look for underscore init within your class function. That this underscore init is what is required to create an instance of this particular class object that you defined.
Okay.
Do you understand that? So I can now say that def. Okay, I can create a new function instead of this underscore init. I can see that I can call this function that this function will return the if it's a is mammal. I can see that it's mammal function. It's mammal. So this function will take the self as the input. So it's only taking itself as the input. So I'm just going to say that if self dot num underscore legs is greater than or equal to 2, then return force. I mean, return to. So that we should return to just, we are going to check the distance we've created. Then if the numbers of leg is equal to, or is greater than or equal to two, then that particular animal is a mammoth.
Okay.
Then return force. So now I've created this particular is mammoth. You should know that this is mammoth. Python will not look for it when you want to call this particular instance.
Mm-hmm.
So I can see that dog dot dog dot is mammoth. This is how to create a, to call this function. So I'm not going to give it any argument because it's really taking safe.
Mm-hmm.
So once I call this function, I'm going to get to. You understand that?
Yes, I do.
Okay. So you can do it. Like, let's create another instance. I can say that fish. We go to animal fish, comma, 0, 0. So I can ask that fish dot is mammal. So this will give us what?
False.
So because the numbers of legs is less than zero.
Mm.
Do you understand that?
Yes, I do.
So that is our object-oriented program work. Your function might not necessarily change, return anything. You understand that? Like in this case, we created a function that does not return something, but it updates the properties of that instance, which is pass accuracy. By reducing it by 50. Do you understand that?
Yes, I do.
So your functions that you are creating within the class function, it might not necessarily change anything. It might not necessarily return anything, but it can change an instance. It can change the properties of the instance you are creating. Like once you call this function, this thing should happen. Once you call this function, this is where you have to put everything there, then you'll be using it. So let's go more technical. Like, I'm going to create an instance of a another function.
Okay.
Let's see that. It's decimal number.
Sorry, sir. Can I just pick this up real quick, sir?
Okay, let me pause.
Okay.
So let's go more technical. I'm going to create an instance of a decimal number.
Okay.
A class with decimal number. So I'm going to call the first function underscore init. So I'm going to call this self comma value. Are you there? So it's going to have self.value equal to value. Are you there?
Yes, sir. I'm here, sir.
Okay. So for example, we have def. Okay, I'm going to call this the first function, let's say decimal number.
Okay.
0.5. So this is the first class. I'm going to call this D1 equal to 0.5.
Okay.
D2 equal to 0.3. So if you look at D1 dot value will give us what?
0.5.
0.5 because that is the value.
Mm-hmm.
Likewise, D2 dot value will give us 0.3. So there's what to call function overloading. Like you can put some other function that is understandable by Python. So the first function is underscore sum. So we have self dot comma. This is going to take self and num. So it's going to return. I'm going to tell you what this function does. Self dot value plus num. So this underscore sum will make it possible for us to use plus like okay. 1 plus 0.4.
Okay.
So this, it will make it possible for me to be able to use, once you use plus sign on our class function, it's going to look that, is there anything like underscore sum, then it is possible for us to plus it with this num.
Okay.
So this num is what is taken as an argument
okay.
of this 0.4. Is the okay. second part of this number.
Okay.
So if I run this, okay, let me look at it very well. Underscore sum. Okay, let's use sub. I don't know if it's sub or add. Okay, wait. That value plus 0.4. Okay, so I think
there's somebody at my door, sir. I'll be back in like 3 minutes now.
Okay. I think it's underscore add.
Let's not some.
Not some. Let's try this. Okay. So it's underscore add. So underscore add is that we are trying to use additions with our functions. So like what happens once you use positive with our functions? And this num is the second number that is adding with that positive. Like the class object is adding with this second number, which is num.
Okay.
Then it should return self.value plus num. Like the value of this self should be added to this num.
Okay.
That is why you have 0.9.
Okay.
Do you understand that? If you have
okay.
2 plus 0.3, now we've coded it that even though our class object is a decimal number object, it's not a float up, we can still add it with a float.
Okay, I have to get the answer.
And still get the answer. And because of this underscore, if you look at, if I have not used this, if I have not used this, this will not be possible because we cannot do this. Because of this, this particular underscore add will make it possible for us to use the addition symbol with our function, with our class instance. Do you understand that? So we also have def underscore sub that allows us to use subtractions. You can see that this one should return self.value minus num. Are you there?
Yes, I'm here. I'm here, sir.
So this, in this case, we'll be able to use addition symbol with our function, subtraction symbol with our function, d2 minus 0.5.
Okay.
You can see that. But you can now see that, okay, instead of doing this, you want us, because all these are returning a float.
Mm-hmm.
You can see that, no, don't return a float. We will be returning a decimal number class. We want to return this decimal number class. So I can just self.value. I'm going to update this value. Self.value equal to this. Then return self. Return that instance back to us. Just update its value, increase the value by adding it with num and return it. Self.value equal to self.value minus num. Then return self. So if we do this, then in this case where I do this, I'm going to get an instance of this. I can call this d3. And this d3 will now have a value of what has been added with this value of this. You can just add d3.value. You can see.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to explain better. We've created an object, an instance. This is template of an instance. It's a decimal number template. Here we
call it.
We create an instance of 0.5 and 0.3. These are this instance D1, D2, and they have values of 0.5 and 0.3, and these value properties. So this __add will allows us to use addition symbol. And this core value that we define is what we are adding with the addition symbol. So we have to have provided the code that what happens once you use the addition symbol.
Okay.
So that's what we did here. Like what I want to use addition symbol with ourselves, this instance that has been created. And what we want to happen is that we want it to add the value of the decimal number with the value of the instance and return an instance which is self. And the same goes here. That is why we can say that d3 equals d1, which have a value of 0.5 plus 0.4. You can see that d3, that value will now be 1.3. Let me run it again. Okay, 0.9.
Okay.
Do you understand that?
Yes, I do.
Okay, so that is how we still have a lot of them. We still have a lot of them, but we will continue on Monday so we can go deeper in this class. It's a very, very technical thing that I won't want to rush into it too much for now.
Okay, I'll just go over this one over the weekend.
Okay, so but you have this assignment.
Okay.
So I'm going to give you this dictionary.
Okay.
Personal data.
Okay.
Okay, it's a list.
Okay.
So let's say that we have a database. Okay, so I'm going to call it database instead.
Okay.
So the first item, there are database of dictionaries. So the first item will be username of individual. Let me say the first username is John K. Let's see, John 2:55.
Okay.
Okay. His password is also strings. Let's see, John 2:53@.
Okay.
We have another username like this. So you create this database, make sure that it's 10. Just put random numbers, something like this. So let's see that another username is maybe Roland25, and the password is Roland65.
Okay,
let's see that's Roland@1. Okay. Let me create one more.
I'll populate it to like 10.
You just create random numbers to 10. Random usernames and password.
Okay.
So in this one, I'm going to say that I'm going to use Eli. And password. Eli65. Let's say this is Eli23 or 1994. And then let's not Eli 25 as the password, 25 #. So do this to like 10. So you are saying not to not create a function.
Okay.
This function will take check username.
Okay.
Password is the name of the function. So let's say that the user wants to sign in and with this particular function. So this function will take username and password.
Okay.
So this function will now return to return check. And this check can either be true or false. I'm going to set check to be equal to false at false. You understand? This function is going to take database as input and username and password as input. And it's going to check if this username that's being provided is within this database, and the password is also the same password of that username.
Okay.
For example, if I check, I call this function like this. I got this function like this. Then I have provided a username of John255.
Okay.
Password of John253@. I should get true. But yeah, I'm getting false because I just defined it false. So I should get it because it's within this database.
Okay.
You understand the idea.
Okay.
But once I mistakenly the password or either of the two, then I should get false.
Okay.
So that is your assignment.
Okay.
Do you understand that?
Yes, I do.
So the hint is that it's for you to look through this database.
Okay.
So while looking through the database, use your if statement to check if the dictionary item, each dictionary item that you are looking to, the username is equal to the username and the password is equal to the password. Then you set your check to be equal to true at that instance. Then you don't check as you return it here.
Okay.
Do you understand the assignment?
Yes, I do, sir.
Okay, so that will be that for today.
Okay, sir.
Thanks, sir. So try to continue. But you can.
Can you send me this file, sir, and the file for the assignment too?
Is that what?
Can you send me this file and the file for the assignment?
Yes. I'm going to send all the files.
Okay.
Thank you, sir. Thank you,
thank
sir.
You very much.